references the FAA lighting in this particular section, but because we have the testing facilities and other things that are in here, I think to the point there's any structures, we're gonna need an egress light, for instance, you know, in some cases. But for any structures that they need, I would really like them to be 0-foot candles at the property line.
Is this a little required to apply for the, it's, they have to apply to the radar detection or aircraft detection?
Then where does it say that?
Oh, that's in all of these items. It's in G, but it only references the FAA requirements. And then it's 1 through 3.
Right.
But it doesn't address annoying spotlights and other necessary things that I'd like to be 0-foot at the property line.
The only thing I'll look at, I don't think there's a similar requirement for any other type of use in township.
Maybe that's why that's close.
Could that be added into the site plan rather than added into the ordinance?
What if they want a motion to that for the light turn on?
As long as it's 0-foot candles when you're sitting on your porch next door, I don't care if it's motion. I just don't want, I'm looking at cell towers that are blinking and nasty that are 4.5 miles away from my house. I want 0-foot candles at the adjacent property. They can get directional lights off their buildings or their gates, but keep it 0 and their light isn't trespassing.
Should that be in the ordinance though, all or in the site plan review? We can stipulate that in the site plan.
Check the ordinance, I don't know if you have a.
You might have, I think there might be a photo, there might be a photometric in there, but I don't want any more lit pollution crossing property lines.
If we're gonna go that route, my suggestion would be to include it in the ordinance, the general amendment to the site plan standards, so you're not targeting this single use for only one that has.
We might have to do that anyway with the goofiness between chapter 13 and this ordinance, so I just need to come back in, or 12 and 13, anyway. The interconnection standards on 30, we're requiring that everything be underground. And we're also setting a depth below grade, but then it does reference the code. There are several cases where they end up daylighting for a lot of reasons. Sorry. It was right after the electromagnetic interference, and then right after that is the interconnection standards.
Okay. Up on just above that, item 3, I got a typo. Responsible part TTs. There's extra T there.
Yeah, I think again we have to look at the day limits there. That day I think is okay, they only have 30 days to deal with the non-compliant. So we're maintaining that everything is underground, and I'm just afraid that while they're doing field work, they're gonna run into something that's gonna prevent them from remaining underground, and they're gonna go above head and then come back down again.
Gonna deal with that.
Yeah. My challenge is, it happens in the field. And we're not a permitting authority or an inspection authority, so.
You do have authority to require underground insulation utilities.
And it will stay there.
Mm-hmm. Up till time and time.
Perfect, that's okay.
That doesn't include the actual power grid.
This is everything. Everything is to be underground.
This is the connection from the turbines to
Yep, this is the substation.
So we're gonna uphold the fact that they can go 100% underground from the point to point?
From turbine to substation.
That is gonna be a hard one.
It gets it's better, they have to buy all the right of way to be able to do it too.
Yeah.
Okay, that's one of my concern with this whole project, because you go to the other areas and they've got these huge power, you know, poles everywhere, point A to point B.
Now to the, so here's my question.
You're saying that we're not gonna have the big huge power pole?
This is saying that it has to be underground.
Saying when you're coming out of that big, you know, substation, out of the grid.
To the road.
You're gonna be able to put that above ground.
Yeah.
Direct from the turbines to, you know, the substation that's collecting all this.
Yeah.
I think that's an enforceable requirement.
So I would just double check to the point in which there's a public utility easement or some other avenue that's already in place.
They're gonna have to go to roadway if they don't get it, if they can't secure it, they're gonna have to take it over.
But we're still not gonna be able to do anything about the actual transport. From the actual substation to the actual next.
Correct.
Yeah. And that's where eminent domain's gonna come in, they're gonna put it wherever they want.
That's correct also.
Exactly. Everybody, everything.
We get a substation on our property.
To the extent to nothing across the line, so.
No, they can go there.
Well, we already know where they want the substation, so.
We do?
Yeah.
They don't even know where the turbine's going yet.
They've already picked out a spot for the substation. Already been leaked.
No, we're up here, so.
Okay. And I think you addressed the waiver as well on item number two, so again, I was just trying to understand enforcement rights. Road use agreements, I think we already talked about that, because that can be a condition of the permit that usually posts.
It says something about the Mahoning County roads within the township. What about the township roads within the township?
There are no township roads.
There's such thing.
There isn't? Okay.
County controls all the roads here in township. Except for state roads.
Because it's kinda like, I know, usually a county road has a number on it. Like 522 down here, Scanton, like that. But then you get the dirt road down, like the road down my house has got a county number on it.
All county roads.
Whether they designate it as a county highway or not, it's still a county road.
Right.
1930, when.
That's why the township doesn't have a road department.
So the applicant shall hold, this is that fiscal security that we talked about, but I wasn't sure how all of this works. Right below it. And then it says again, we've got to review every 5 years and increase 2 times the limit. I'm not sure how the enforcement of this works and what that process looks like.
We did that because we don't know where things are going.
Well, they have to restore everything at the completion of the project. So I'm not understanding the logic behind this item, I don't know.
Well, they're required to put financial security up in advance, in amount agreed to by the township and the road commission to pay for the cost of anticipated damage to the road they'll create by bringing these systems into the township. And so what happens if they don't do that repair? The township and or the road commission together can call on that bond or financial security and use that money itself to do repairs.
Okay, so the way you just defined that, then we would potentially have a project, or we would have a bond, for instance, for our portion, a different township would have a bond for their portion, and we would independently have to call on those particular bonds?
This went forward, and it's proposed to be a multi-township project, and maybe very well, but Mahoning County Road Commission would require a global bond for everywhere the project is.
So then how would we, are we then reliant on our relationship with Mahoning County to get them to actually?
No, the idea is that we would, because if
town fails to act, how do we, as Douglas Township, a smaller part of a greater thing, what is our relationship like to compel? If it's a bond or is it cash sitting in a bank?
Well, I think, to some sense, you have to believe there's gonna be a good say on the road commission, that they're gonna want these things fixed as well, but really, this situation we're in now, we can't compel the road commission in any circumstance to do anything to the roads, really. So this is once the better that the pot of money is sitting there, and I don't think the road commission anymore wants things to sit on the chair, so I think that's a real concern that we have to get. Cooperation with that.
And then it says the amount shall be reviewed every 5 years. Well, if this project takes 5 years, we've got bigger problems.
And a 6-year plan going into this.
But they would only, that's why I said this is like a deferred submittal. They don't do this till after the stuff is done, and it has to be in place prior to construction. So I looked at Isabella, I think they really, construction was only like 2 years. So I didn't understand the whole logic in that one.
Yeah, I think you could make a reasonable argument that 5 years is kind of like, you know, that's for sure.
So shall we review it after the third year if the project's not complete? And deem if there's additional escrow monies needed for inflation?
Yeah, I like I said, I'm not telling you which way to do it. I didn't ask the.
I mean, is that wording proper?
You just changed the 5 to 3.
Yes.
So, do you want to review it every 3 years?
I want to say if the project's not completed in 3 years.
You're gonna review the roads.
We're gonna review the roads and make them put more money in the kitty if the project's not done. I don't want a project dragged out.
Right, but not every 3 years forever.
Just a one-time 3 year?
No, if they don't complete the project after 3 years, we're gonna ding them for cash. If they don't repeat, they don't complete the project in 6 years, we're gonna ding them again.
But once the project's completed, you won't be doing that.
Correct.
Think of that?
So I would recommend that we have a.
I like that, that's better.
Rick, you do that?
Yeah.
Okay.
So my motion is to get it. Yep.
This would be unanimous, because now we'll change 5 to 3.
Say, if it's been 5 years, it's in the grand year, 3 or 4 things, probably do that at 3 years.
Do that too?
Yep.
On the next page.
Yep. Now, so, some of the neighboring counties, whatever, they've gone back to a couple more permits, so, and that's been in excess of 3 years. So they're gonna be looking at redoing roads again over there.
And we're gonna be getting more.
Yeah, they came back with that kind of thing.
So the drain, that was in item number 2, right?
Yep.
Yeah. So on this one, under the drainage, item 2, there's a subset, Muscles Managed Security, determined by all 3 parties. And then all repairs must be completed within 90 days of the project. So does 3 years apply in this case if repairs are not done in these 90 days from project completion and not exceed 365? We need to check from there.
No, it's okay. What you're saying is, well, the project is still ongoing and we're not completed, we got to update the financial security every 3 years.
Yep.
But once they're done, they got 90 days, both with respect to roads and with respect to
drainage.
Gotcha. To complete the work. We need to let advance it done.
Okay. So the next one is the noise. The shadow flicker, I didn't see any changes on that one. And I think as long as we have them more restricted, if anything changes, that shadow. shadow collectors in the Department of Energy and DEQ and DNR, so. So my question on this one is, I think ambient noise is already a 40.
Yeah, I would suggest that the 35 is probably unreasonable result.
Yeah. So, I think to the
I looked at some decibel tables, and I think if you change that from 40 to 45 and 35 to 40, it's still well within reasonable limits. And again, it's at the property line. So the occupied dwellings are not going to be right on the property line. It's even more distance there. 40 decibels is equivalent to a quiet lighter.
We said in a house with that.
Let me finish.
No.
45 is equivalent to bird calls. Farm noise ranges from 80 to 100 decibels. So again, we don't want to create noise impacts, but we need to understand what 40 or 45 decibels is in the real world and be reasonable about these requirements.
Okay, I did a test thing a month ago. A little lawnmower, probably, I don't know, 100 feet away, okay? And it was at 40 or 45, whatever. But that's not 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. That's hoping the thing runs out of gas or goes away. Your quiet library is just not the same place.
Well, a lawnmower is like 85 decibels.
Mm-hmm. Well, this was
100 feet away,
and it was at 40.
Mm-hmm. So my
and it was annoying. It's all
get
out.
I get it.
So my question here, guys, is they have to do a background study before they even submit this project of what the existing conditions are with nothing there. They have to have a baseline for what's there, and then they overlay their modeling with natural wind movements, occasional car traffic, whatever it is, the 40 is going to be hard for them to not exceed in their base study. So what happens when their base study, before anything is in place, already exceeds this? Is that giving them a window in which they could say, we have an unrealistic expectation when the existing conditions without us already exceed those?
I don't think that's true. The answer to your question is yes.
I mean, today, I put the app on my phone, and I was in our shop. I went in the bathroom and shut the door in the bathroom. There wasn't any in the morning, and I had 40 decimals just sitting there in a quiet bathroom.
I'm watching the app on Tammy's phone. While Paul was talking, it was 52 decibels. While Rick was talking, it was 55. While Tammy was talking, it was 62. So you're asking for way lower than that just at the property line.
Yes.
I don't see that.
I don't want to hear people
talk. Right, but I'm saying, and you're asking for even lower at the property line. I think 40 is, most people don't talk on that.
We're talking about people who have not had noise at the property line before.
No noise, there's no cars, there's no
bad noises there. I live on the highway. I have noise all the time.
But
you're adding noise at a property line that has not experienced that noise. That 24, where I went, and you should go if you haven't, is over here east to that, I can't remember her name, and hers was at 52. They came out and tested it. It's a monster. And that sounded like jet engines going off. It had a, and I asked the Albert here, and I go, because he'd gone over too. I said, well, what would you have done about that? He goes, well, we would have done it in a more responsible manner. You can't stand being in the yard.
And those are 1,500 feet from the home.
With that turbine, and they're not doing anything about it.
Well, if there's something wrong with it and they're not doing anything about it, that's an entirely separate issue.
The noise level is.
Nobody does anything about it.
They said it was at 52, at the property line, or at the, out by the horse pasture, whatever, was at 52. And I got out and I'm going, if this is 52, I don't know how much noise increases when you go up each area of that, but it was, I wouldn't live there for any reason. It was annoying, very bad.
Keep in mind, when you talk about these numbers, one thing that came out of in here, the sound scale is logarithmic. So, you can go to 40 to 50, that's not 25% higher, it's 100% higher.
Well, whatever, I'm not a sound expert.
So, my point is, when you talk about 52 versus the 45 and 40, we're talking about moving here, it's a more dramatic decrease than you think, because it's not a linear scale. Noise is not a logarithmic scale, at least it doesn't.
So, right now we have 50 and 45. I believe the baseline is going to exceed everything that's set here.
That's unparticipated.
I'm looking at the participating is on the top.
Right.
At 50.
It's actually the noise sensitive facility, so at a house.
Correct.
Those are the levels. But the one we were talking about was the second box of non-participating parcels going from 40 to 45 and 35 to 40.
And 45 can definitely mean that the Lakeland project complies with that.
Yeah, the 40 and the 45, correct. I think the baseline is going to come back. We're at 41 until you click your pin.
Yeah. What's the pleasure of the planning commission on this issue?
I say we leave it as written.
I second that.
A motion?
Make a motion, leave it as is.
Did you support it?
I did.
Any other discussion? Pat?
No.
Todd?
No.
Tammy?
No.
Becky?
No.
Yes?
Motion defeated. What's the pleasure of the planning commission now?
I believe the 45 and 50 as recommended, especially by legal counsel. I believe the base studies.
45 and 40.
40, yeah, 45 and 40.
We didn't recommend that.
We did not recommend that.
Because I believe the baselines are going to come back at that or exceeding.
Is there a second?
I'd like to see what the lawyer says. What's coming?
Yeah, what Paul and I both recommended was for the non-participating parcel numbers to move those to 45 daytime and 40 nighttime.
Yes.
That's what I understand the motion.
I didn't hear the motion, but they said it like that.
I heard it backwards, that we were talking first about the non-participating, not the participating at 45 and 40. If you're talking about the participating, it's lowering those levels then.
No, those are the same.
It's the bottom line.
Okay.
You're going to 45 and 40.
You still expect.
Okay, so those are going up.
Becky, you seconded that, right?
Yes.
Is there any other discussion? Pat?
Yes.
Todd?
No.
Tammy?
Yes.
Becky?
Yes.
Rick?
No.
Motion carries. Can we move on?
Forty and 45.
Question again, just on the sound model study. If you could do that same carve out more restrictive than in case technology changes.
It does say most recent version of ANSI.
Yeah.
wanna give them twelve, so they've got the sound measurement post-construction survey. And it says within 12 months of the commencement of operation. Do we really wanna give them 12 months?
You really need 12 months, that's gonna be pushing it.
Okay.
Those studies are very, we discussed it at a prior planning commission meeting, but those studies are very difficult to perform to get the ideal conditions where you've got maximum power and conditions where there's not so much background noise that it's hard to separate the turbine noise. Several years as the Lake Williams project where they can successfully do it a few times, and by court order they had to go back and do it several more times, and they're 3 years to complete it there.
Okay. So they would have to come back and get an extension after 1 year and 12 months from the completion of the project.
Yeah.
If we contemplated any extension fees for anything that doesn't fall within this time?
The escrow provisions that provided any of the sound studies, they have to pay for money for the next project.
Yeah, I didn't know if that escrow was also for plan review by third-party experts and some other things there.
There's a global one up front, which is non-specific. The board hasn't acted on this yet, but as you point out, at the last meeting, the board did adopt a general escrow policy that allows them to collect fees for those type of things. The studies talked about what they didn't act on yet is the one that has the specific dollar amount in it, because they wanted the township administrative staff to review those to make sure they're appropriate. But the draft figure we put in was $100,000 up front just for generalized zoning review, separate and apart from the sound study, all the financial security. So you'll have to cough up that money right at the beginning.
So how are you handling escrow deposits for other companies? You know, are you dealing with the scale, based on the type of content?
Yeah, some might only be $500, some might only be $200. You know, somebody's coming in for a special land use for, I don't know, let's say.
Like a church.
Yeah.
Adult foster care. So is there a point in time where we want to look at what we're able to review inside and what we need a third-party expert to review, whether it's a traffic study, whether it's anything of technical nature, to where we've got a lifetime, at least here, some preliminary proposals that we've got for being realistic, because I hate to set 500 bucks in.
The escrow policy allows you to increase it at any time, as long as the expenses are reasonably related to evaluating the project and are negotiable with the cost the township actually has incurred, they are enforceable as a certain amount at that point. And so even if $100,000 was enough, you can say, okay, we're not reviewing any further until you replenish your power. And the statement that's up front of the ordinance allows that to be used for any number of things, engineering studies, environmental studies, attorney, planner, review, anything that you incur that's related to the mm-hmm.
We definitely have to have noise experts, because people who are getting barking dogs could reject. Never did get through that.
Mechanical acoustics. Reports on item number 8 that are at 45 days of completion post construction. Reporting of measurement data, sound measurement personnel. 29 in this one. And I think, Paul, you just recopied the same requirements from the initial study book. So it's really not a year, it's a year plus 45 days.
Well, they have a year to actually do the field work, then when it's done, they go get you the 4.45.
Just making sure I was linking this together.
The way these things play out is they'll hire their own sound consultant who will do a parallel study, and they will be nitpicking everything your consultant does to disagree with them, because they're gonna have a very in-friendly consultant, and you're gonna have a neutral party, and imagine how that plays out, but it does at every project.
So we've got a decommissioning, bond or survey that needs to be relooked at every 2 years based on the rate of 1.5 times. It's at the decommissioning, 7. A7. And again, that kind of goes to that whole decommissioning bond and how all of that works globally, because I think they do their bonding based on the project, right? So we would only be a portion of. So in light of the diabolic collapse in California about 25 years ago, do we want to have any provisions for bonding at all as far as AAA rated? Do we want any financial security strength to illustrate that